Are you looking to expand your musical horizons in a massive way? If so, you need to check out Thoughts and Experiments with Solo Piano, the first ever course from the 15-time Grammy-nominated pianist Fred Hirsch. Described by Vanity Fair as the most arrestingly innovative pianist in jazz over the past decades. Equal parts Zen master, psychologist, and old-school piano teacher, taskmaster, Fred Hirsch brings 45 years of experience as a master jazz pianist and composer to bear in his teachings. Fred focuses you on the underlying process of music making, regardless of the level of music information you have at your command, all in the service of helping you become a better solo pianist and a more creative and emphatic jazz musician. And as Fred says, love the music and it will love you back. So check out Thoughts and Experiments with Solo Piano from Fred Hirsch, available now exclusively at openstudiojazz.com. Now let's get into today's show.
Hey, Peter.
Hey, Adam.
Do you remember the 90s?
Ooh, do I remember them? I cherish them. I love them. I want to go back to them.
Well, buckle up, buddy. I'm Adam Maness.
And I'm Peter Martin.
And you're listening to the You'll Hear Podcast.
Music advice coming at you from any decade.
From any decade. You know what I've never said before in my entire life till about 30 seconds ago?
Hey, Peter.
No. I've said that way too much. Buckle up, buddy. Where the hell did that come from?
You know what it is? Buckle up, buddy. We're going to the 90s.
Sometimes, you know, sometimes the red light's on. You just don't know what's going to come out.
Ugh, buckle when the red up. Light comes on, we...
I was like, oh, well, buttle up, Bucky.
Let's butter it up. Oh, man. Well, you know what, though? You're right, though. Buckle up, because this... We're talking about an era that I think is just an amazing, groundbreaking, swinging, grooving, tradition-laden era of jazz, the 90s.
Would you Would you say that this is an underrated era? I would.
You know, it's both underrated and overrated at the same time. I don't know why.
People are not nostalgic enough and yet too nostalgic about the 90s, for sure.
I love the way, actually, Nicholas Payton came up with a hashtag on this. It's like back in the 90s. It's a very long hashtag, so it's had trouble catching along. And back in the 90s when cats were really swinging, that's like that's like more than one tweet, even the hashtag, you know.
Yeah.
But I think that there is, I think there is something to be said about it, you know. And I have to be careful here because I'm from that era. You're almost from the era, but I think that you're a little safer because you were just dabbling as a pro in the 90s. But you got to be careful yourself.
I was dabbling as a pro. I was just barely a pro in the 90s, and I was loving the music from, like, I mean, I guess really 94, 95 is when I started to listen to a lot of jazz and really get into it.
Yeah.
So, which was a great era to get into it, you know what I mean? Like, because if you, I mean, you could go to, there was a lot of live music still, first of all.
Right.
So we used to go down to the Hotel Majestic when I was a kid.
Yeah.
Just Jazz.
Did your dad take you to?
Yeah,
my dad did too. We got to get your dad and my dad together.
It's possible the four of us were there checking out like the Ray Brown trio at some point.
No, this was way before you were there. Yeah.
But so it was. It's definitely everything we have today. I grew up listening to, I think, as you did. But you're on some of these. So,
well, no. I'm not supposed to be. We had a little agreement on that I was not going to actually be on any of these. But
this. But it's buddy.
But I did some stuff during
my humble friend Peter. You have to be on some of these 90s. You know what I mean? Like, come on, man.
Well, no. So the ones that I pick, there's a bunch of artists that are friends and that I've worked with and played and recorded with. But I avoid anything that I'm on, not out of shame or anything, just. These are, like, what do we call these? Favorites. I just really put down my favorites. I could have put down 10 more, 20 more. You could have.
There could have been 20 more. These are really a sampling. And we're going to count them down from 7 down to 1.
Ooh, I like that.
And I would say it's in no particular order, but there's definitely an order to this. Where I think we're going from my
best
perspective.
Best to worst? Worst to best?
Worst to best. No, there's no worst in the group.
Of course not.
But it's really just, I think, when I think of favorite 90s albums, I think of albums that really had huge impacts on all the players.
I think of favorite albums. And
you're going to fit in right with number 7. Shall we get into it?
When I everything
but it worked really well with
it. Right. Oh, but I digress.
But you digress. So let's get into it here.
Oh, we really are starting at the bottom of the list. Now, see, ooh, there I said it again, the bottom of the list. The bottom of the list is a great place.
Dude, I mean, if you check out, like, the bottom of the list is the Brad Mehldau Trio. So that's a pretty amazing place to start. Come
on. That lets you guys know what the high quality level we're talking about when number seven is.
Yeah,
Brad
so Mehldau. Really any of the first three or four Brad Mehldau albums, which I think were all in the 90s, could have made this list. But I went with the classic Art of the Trio, Volume 1. Of course, Brad Mehldau on piano, Larry Gunadier on the bass, Jorge Rossi on drums. This is, I think, a really influential album for a lot of pianists and piano trios.
Oh, probably the most influential trio album, certainly of that decade.
That decade. So this is you know what, man?
Uh-oh, he's calling an audible. I can see him. Look at him. He's getting excited over there. He's going, woo.
I'm gonna switch it up here. I'm gonna switch it up to let's play. I don't know what time. I didn't know what time it was.
Okay.
I had a Lennon McCartney track on here, and I realized that we're live.
Oh, that was good. That was actually that's good. Right, yeah, same album, Volume 1, yeah. Live at the Village Vanguard.
I didn't know what time it was.
Yeah.
Guys were born without a sixth beat.
I know. They had five fingers and five toes just like the rest of us.
That's the language right there.
Yeah.
So there's the Brad Mehldau Trio with the trio's unique sense of rhythm, sense of dynamics.
Sense of groove. And I love, like, I remember hearing them right around, I was definitely at that gig that week when they're at the Vanguard. I believe that this came from the entire, this is not from
that
the
was
Vanguard.
Number two was live at the Vanguard. This was actually a studio record. Okay. Number one was a studio record.
Well, somebody did their homework. Somebody didn't. Apparently, my bad.
But
I was going to say, I was like, what a studio sound that they got at that volume two. Okay.
No, it's volume two, three, and four are all at the Vanguard, I believe.
Okay, no problem.
Yeah. I could be wrong about that, but it was
rip that up. No problem.
No, but he was kind of like doing a lot of stuff live, doing a lot of stuff in the studio, but this one was live in the studio. This one was in the studio. That's I didn't know what time it was. And again, man, the sound of that trio, it's like one of those groups, especially with Jorge Rossi, where it's just like, yeah, that's that 90s Mehldau trio.
That's right. That's right. And I mean, Larry Grenadier, I think that this was the first time when I really sort of somewhat consciously started to think about, especially in a trio setting, like playing in five and playing in seven in a way in which the bass player and the drummer and the pianist are not feeling the overall architecture of that groove exactly the same way. And I won't go deep into this because then it's a little bit controversial, because it's like, wait, they're all feeling the groove. Of course they are. But what really, I think, hits on some of the advanced concepts they had and how to take advantage of that unique trio and that trident of instruments was the way that Brad would dance over a bigger phrase of that five while Larry would be like really digging in, and Jorge would kind of go back and forth. Yeah. And like they would explore those options in really interesting ways. And I remember hearing that at the time. I was like, wow, that's a hip way of playing over that.
Yeah.
And it always kind of stuck with me.
But it always makes sense and always feels right. That trio is a listen that I recommend for people trying to get into odd meters.
Yes.
You know, for like things like 5-7.
Yep.
Because
it's super natural, but there's a lot of advanced stuff that as you get into it, even years later, you can come back and be like, ah, that's how they did
it. It feels
that.
Earthy and organic. And
Yeah.
So, Peter, let me ask a question.
Yes.
What if I told you there was an album that had not only Joshua Redman?
Yes.
But Branford Marsalis?
Yes.
Stanley Turrentine?
Yes.
Joe Henderson?
Yes.
Ron Blake?
Yes.
And Johnny Griffin? Would that be something that would interest you?
Yes, I'm in. You had me at Stanley Turrentine.
Now, what if it also had Rodney Whittaker on bass, Gregory Hutchinson on drums, Cyrus Chestnut on piano, but it wasn't any of these players' albums.
Right.
Is this something you would listen to?
This is something I would listen to. This is something that, I mean, these are my guys. This was my era.
Pretty awesome, yeah. Man. Just I saying mean, that out loud. So this
but,
is.
But bigger than that, well, yeah. No. I'm in and all that. You had me at Roy Hargrove back. Oh, sorry.
I didn't say Hargrove. Yeah, come on, man. No, this is Roy Hargrove's Tenors of Our Time, 1994, an amazing record. I mean, just if it was just Roy and the rhythm section and one of these guys, that would be awesome. But all of those tenor saxophonists I mentioned are making an appearance on this album.
And I'll just, you know, full disclosure, the reason I picked this one was because I was kind of like, I got to have Roy on. It's the 90s, but there's so many great records of his. But this one I felt like was it's just one of my favorites, first of all. But it's also, I think, a great intersection of Roy's master, you know, really being a master of developing a young band of his peers. Mm. And of course, with that rhythm section, you know, especially Greg Hutchinson and Rodney Whitaker, those two bass and drums, and then Ron Blake being associated with Roy in terms of two horn players and Cyrus. I mean, it doesn't get any better than that. But also with his, you know, uncanny ability to connect with the masters, the older generation, the Stanley Turrentines, the Johnny Griffins. And, you know, I had the pleasure of playing with both of them with Roy, and like Roy fit in like he was one of the old heads. We were all just kind of like, oh, we're so excited to play. But I mean, Roy was just like, he was just like an old soul, you know? And so this record, and with the tenor, it's such a great ability of Roy to play with saxophones, you know, it kind of brought all those worlds together. So
let's check out Soppin' the Biscuit.
First track. Yeah, Roy's.
Noodles stood out. This is Cyrus Chestnut?
I can't help it.
Can't help it, man. It feels too good. That's Soppin' the Biscuit from With the Tenors of Our Time. Roy Hargrove, 1994. Incredible. Just incredible. Yeah, I can't recommend that one enough, man. Any of these actually worth a deep dive. Listen. So next up, it's the first appearance of a vocalist from this is actually the last year of the 90s, 1999.
Yes.
This is Diane Reeves. You know Diane?
I do know Diane, and you know what? I think, if you were to press me on my favorite Diane record, I mean, I just love her. I love Diane, and I love her as a musician, as a vocalist, as a person. But I know her records really well, going all the way back to, you know, Palo Alto Sessions, Better Days, Never Too Far, the old school 80s Blue Note stuff. That's for another episode.
Well, we got to do I Love the 80s next.
I love the 80s, right. Yeah. But I think that if I were to be pressed on one album of any era, I don't know. But if I chose this one, I would be okay with my decision. There's like four of her records that I think are just pinnacle, but like the Mount Rushmore. But this one was probably...
It's a beautiful record.
Yeah, Bridges.
This is Bridges from 1999. There's a really long list of great players who play on this entire album. But this track, Suzanne... this features Reginald Veal on the bass.
Yep. Brian Blade at the drums.
I think it's Billy Childs on this one.
Yep. Billy Childs. And he did the arrangement of this of the incredible, I believe it's Leonard Cohen, right? Did Suzanne?
Yeah.
And Leonard Cohen's song.
Kenny Garrett plays the saxophone.
Oh man. Just check out for folks that don't know this track, check out, and Kenny Garrett is gonna make another appearance later. The haunting Kenny Garrett saxophone playing at the very beginning of this track is just one of the things that just makes me my heart soar. But that this alone kind of pushes it into the conversation, at least.
One more credit here: the great Romero Lubombo plays guitar in this.
That's track, right, so. Absolutely, and produced by a gentleman by the name of George Duke, who is gone but far from forgotten.
Amazing.
A great guy.
Legend. Here's Suzanne from Bridges, Diane Reeves, 1999. Okay, I'm sorry we got to start this again because, dude, like, I forgot about this album.
Oh my God.
And how incredible. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, and also,
this is a great thing about doing these, like, throwback playlists. You know what I mean?
Right. And Munyongo Jackson, big, like, a lot of the percussion and soundscape stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, all of it that's outside of what Brian Blade is doing on the drums. That's Munyongo Jackson, which is amazing, too. You really hear that at the beginning.
You know, like, some of these, it's like, you know, it's like, I have this checked as, like, I love that album.
Yeah.
But then when you hear it again for the first time in a while, you're like, oh, man, that's why. Here it is again. Suzanne. Mm. Can you hear it? Wow.
Suzanne takes you down to a place near the river. You can hear the boats go by. You can spend the night beside her. And you know that she's half crazy, but that's why you want to be there. And she feeds you tea and oranges that come all the way from China. And just when you mean to tell her that you have no love to give her, then she gets you on her wavelength and she lets the river answer that you've
great.
Suzanne, Diane Reeves, just amazing. Billy Childs on the arrangement, amazing.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I would just say that the arrangement that Billy does on that and the production from George Duke, the incredible musicianship, the incredible vocalist, I mean, it just, vocals, it all comes together in a way that's just magical.
The production has a very 90s flavor to it in the best possible way. Like,
yes.
All of the, like Romero's guitar sound with the piano in there.
Yeah.
It's just so beautiful, man.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay, next up, number four is from the great Nicholas Payton, Payton's Place, 1998. This is, I think, one of my all-time favorite albums, not of just the 90s, but of any decade. And you've got Back to the Source here as the chosen track.
I love this whole record. I love all of Nicholas's stuff. He was young in the 90s, but to me, along with Roy, he just really typifies that sound. And we were joking before about the hashtag back in the 90s when cats were really swinging. But just check out the vibe. Adonis Rose on drums, Nicholas, Tim Warfield, Ruben Rogers at the bass, friend of the pod, Ruben Rogers.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But when they come in, I don't know. Anthony Wanzi on, like, this was such a tight quintet that they had for a long time that Nicholas had. But the vibe, the kind of sass that they played with. Sass? I don't know if that's the right word. You know, just, what do you call that? Not sass.
I definitely don't call it sass.
They got sassy.
Oh
my no.
Gosh.
Just the vibe and the verve. And this is one of...
Back to the sass.
This is one of several Verve records, which definitely had its own sound with the great engineers.
We have a couple Verve records up in here. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's right.
Verve was making it happen in the 90s.
That's right.
For sure.
Back in the 90s when cats were really swinging.
Here's Back to the Source. Payton's Place. So good.
Classic quintet and P quintet.
Mm-hmm. Here's the thing. This whole album is like this.
I know.
Like, the whole album is swinging.
Let's just listen to the whole album. Come on, man. No, I mean literally the whole album. Wansie.
Seriously, though, does anybody combine swing and sound like Nicholas Payton? I mean, there's no other trumpet player that I think can touch the swing and the sound of Nicholas
Absolutely.
Payton.
Absolutely. And I think the way also that he wrote for this classic, I mean, tenor, trumpet, piano, bass, and drums, it's simultaneously so easy and so difficult to pull off because it's been done well and just, you know, exemplified so strongly by the Miles Davis Quintet. So it's like, where do you run from that? How are you influenced that by that? Or do you run from it or whatever? And to be Nicholas, I mean, Wynton Marsalis with the quintet in the 80s, that original quintet, I say that he did that a lot as well in a different way. Mm. But to me, you know, this quintet writing and the way they played, the details in that with the bass lines and the left-hand piano, very 90s, super hard swinging, super sophisticated, detail-oriented, great dynamics, great groove, great kind of flair for details and groove.
And again, just to make it clear to everybody, there are several glaring omissions from our list here.
Oh, yeah.
And the fact that there's not a Marsalis on the list is a little weird, actually.
Yeah. Why did you omit him?
People in the chat, I mean, there's just so many great records we could have chosen.
Top seven. We didn't say, come on.
we just said favorite seven.
Yeah.
We could do our own, we should actually do a Marsalis playlist at some point of all the entire Marsalis family.
And look, go ahead.
You know what I mean? Just make a playlist of our favorite Marsalis albums from all of the Marsalis clan. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and look, full disclosure, I just realized, you know who we left off of here? So this actually excuses us from leaving Winton and all these other. Herbie Hancock. A guy named Herbie Hancock on here.
There's no Keith Jarrett. There's no Herbie Hancock. There's no Chick Corea. There's nothing.
All those guys were great. Ron Carter, a lot of great stuff.
A lot of great stuff.
So give us some slack. These are just
Freddie Hubbard. I mean, there's legends that are just left off. Hold on. So the next couple are, we have two legends here coming up. This is another Verve record. This is, we've talked about this on the podcast many, many, many times.
Yeah.
This song, I'm never, ever tired of playing in my musical career. Whenever a singer who, I'm lucky to be playing with a few singers here in St. Louis who can really sing this song. And it's just the highlight of the gig every single time. And this whole album, man, this is Shirley Horn, Here's to Life, of course. The arranging, didn't you say the string arranging here is just taking her piano chords?
Well, I believe Johnny Mandel, this is what I heard from some reputable sources that I believe were actually at the session, was that they recorded most of these tracks, if not all of them, with just Shirley Horn with her trio, with Charles Abels and Steve Williams, which is a great track. I got a chance to hear them live a bunch of times. Amazing. I mean, one of the great, kind of unheralded as a trio. Everybody knows Shirley Horn, of course, but she had a great trio with her playing. But that she recorded these tunes, just playing them trio, and the strings were arranged and added afterwards by Johnny Mandel.
Yeah, so this is Charles Abels on the bass, Steve Williams on the drums, and Johnny Mandel as the arranger and conductor from Shirley Horn playing piano and singing Here's to Life. This is 1992.
No complaints and no regrets. I still believe in chasing dreams and placing bets. But I have learned that all you give is all you get. So give it all you've got. I had my share, I drank my fill, and even though I'm satisfied, I'm hungry still to see what's down another road beyond a hill and do it all again.
Hollywood, baby.
So here's to life. And every joy it brings. So here's to life. To dreamers and their dreams.
It's Shirley Horn, Here's to Life, 1992. Amazing. Amazing everything. Amazing piano playing. Amazing singing, amazing arranging, everything, yeah. Everything.
And I just want to say a big shout out to just everybody that was part of this, but David Baker was the engineer of this. I got a chance to work with him a little bit. He's not with this anymore. One of the just true masters. And, you know, I think that I mean, the engineering is always important. Like to the casual listener, not even to the casual listener, to the very intent listener, they may not realize what an impact production and engineering has on the final product. I would say when you hit this very high level in terms of musicianship and album production and engineering, as does this record, almost an equal impact, if not an equal impact. I mean, it's all part of the same team and all part of the same impact. And so David Baker had such a his thumbprint was all over this record.
It can't make the music better.
Well,
but it can make it worse.
You ever heard a little thing called auto-tune? Not on Shirley Horn's records.
No. No, but it can't make up for bad music.
Right.
But
You can't polish a turd.
But you can also, you could really lose some stuff. You know, right. You could lose the polish.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. So. That's right.
So the next album, this is also early 90s, also 1992, actually. This is Joe Henderson, and this was a big moment in Joe Henderson's career.
A little more verve.
I believe he won the Grammy for this.
He did.
Lush Life, the music of Billy Strayhorn, an amazing record.
He won the Grammy. I remember this because this is, of course, Greg Hutchinson playing drums on this.
Chris McBride playing bass.
Bass, right. Although on this track is only, I believe is only, oh wait, which track are we
listening
to?
Take the A-Train.
Yeah, I think this is just a duo.
Yeah.
Gregory Hutchinson and Joe Henderson. But I remember after this won a Grammy, you know, I was super tight with Greg, still am, and Christian, all them. But I remember Greg being like, "Yo, man, I won a Grammy before you." Ha ha ha. Like he definitely said that a lot around this time. "Yo, I'm 21 years old. I got a Grammy. Peace."
Well, the whole album, I mean, so it's the rhythm section are all real, like it's a young Christian McBride, a young Gregory Hutchinson, a young Stephen Scott on piano.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. Wynton Marsalis plays trumpet on a couple tracks,
On that doo dee doo. He does some great work on that. What's that tune?
Is this David Baker too, this record, production-wise?
I don't think so, but that's a great question.
It's another verb. It's the same year. But this the sound of this album.
It's Richard Seidel produced. I do know that.
Oh, amazing. So the sound of this album is incredible. This is Take the A-Train from Lush Life, the music of Billy Strayhorn, Joe Henderson, 1992. Joe's ever played better than on this kind of stuff here on this record, man. This is like, it's hard not to put this up there in his whole amazing career of work as one of the great works of art.
It was a fun, it was a fun time, I think, for Joe Henderson because, I mean, Joe Henderson, if you go back to like the classic Blue Note records and, you know, Mode for Joe and Isotope and all the great tracks and records in the 60s on Blue Note as leader and as assignment. I mean, he sounded like this. I mean, he was already Joe, obviously.
Yeah.
I mean, like high level, but there did seem to be kind of, it seemed to be a little bit, I mean, in the 70s, he had some great great recordings too, you know.
It was good all around.
It
man.
Was
Let's
good.
Be honest.
So like he hit every era where he could kind of stay himself, but then connect like with young players. And it was such a great idea. And I think it was Richard Seidel that came up with this. And I remember I was, I mean, I don't mean to put myself in this. I was a little salty because I know I was on the list for this record and as one of the possible people to be
no
on.
No way.
It. Yeah, but you know what? I'm glad it didn't happen because everything happens for a reason. That's wrong. You know when people say that? No, not everything happens for a reason.
You're like, I wanted to be on this record.
Yeah. No, I didn't get cheated out. Stephen Sky killed me. But, I mean, sometimes you can't be like, I'm glad. No, I wish that I had been. But, you know, grateful for the many other
opportunities. It's understandable, man.
But I remember because they were talking about, they're like, we're going to have some young cats with Joe Henderson and it was going to be a whole thing. And so I'm super proud of like our generation because Christian McBride and Gregory Hutchinson.
Oh, Hutch is laying it down there, man.
Yeah, and Stephen Scott, like those are like my guys that I can't, we were like the young lions at the time. And so the fact that they went in there and not only held their own with Joe Henderson, but were, you know, just like kind of inspired him in a way, yet still being respectful. And it's funny because if you talk to Greg Hutchinson and Christian McBride about these records, they're like, oh man, like they don't like the way they played on it.
Really?
Oh yeah, totally. Wow. Like we should have Greg on sometime to talk about this because he's just like, nah. And to me it's like, it's hard because I'll tell him, man, like you already doing all, I mean, you heard that brushwork.
Yeah.
And then when he went, I mean, it's just like he was already there. So I think Greg takes that to mean like, oh, he hasn't developed since then, you know, which obviously he has. But it's kind of like what we're talking about with Joe Henderson back in the 60s and the 70s, the 80s, and then the 90s.
Yeah.
Killing it all the way through.
No, but there's something to the story of hearing a youthful master, someone who is in the early part of their journey, but obviously insanely talented, as Hutch and Christian McBride were making this album, man. Yeah. I love hearing that. I love it. Especially, I guess now it's a different thing because I've heard all of Gregory Hutchinson's career since, so I know what came out of that. So
exactly.
I guess I understand where he's coming from with that.
Yeah.
So number one, that was number two.
Yeah.
Number one of our favorite albums from the 90s.
In no particular order. Just
in a very particular order, though.
Because we left off, I know a lot of people like.
But for these seven, we kind of put them in an order of, I think, importance. Well, I don't know. Maybe it is no particular order. I just think that this album, the one that we have for number one, is...
It's probably already on the Spotify playlist. Okay, cool.
Everybody can see it. It's it's Kenny Garrett's Songbook, of course.
Yes.
But to me, this is like when I think of hard-hitting 90s jazz albums, this is the first thing that comes to mind.
When cats were really swinging. Is that what you're trying to say?
Yeah. So this is Jeff Tane Watts, Nat Reeves on bass, Kenny Kirkland on piano, and Kenny Garrett on saxophones. And every track is bangers, as they say. There's no skips on this one.
I just was like, you know, we've talked about some of the other tracks before. So
we listened to this on the listening sesh, and it was just it's almost like face meltingly too much for anything.
Exactly. But I think this track, because, and it's funny because this is very much Kenny Garrett's record. A lot of strong personalities, in particular Kenny Kirkland, of course, the late great Kenny Kirkland, that I think did some of his most glorious work on this particular album. And with this particular band, having heard it live, and there's a lot of great YouTube stuff out there available, which is fun. But I think Kenny Kirkland and Jeff Watts, like they were kind of the bridge between the 80s sound and the 90s sound and beyond. And they probably, you know, not to get into too controversial of an area, for drummers and for pianists, they're probably the two most influential players of their generation, which is still like, I mean, Kenny left us way too early, but Jeff Watts is still out here not only doing his things, but innovating on top of what he already innovated on 40 years ago in a really weird way, because he's not only still contemporary, he's like ahead of himself. He's already, you know, like on the track races when you're circling other people and you're like, oh, he's in third place now. No, he's already two laps ahead.
Yeah.
He's lapping everybody, And so I think, but certainly in terms of influence, both with this particular sound of how they played together, but also with the quartet. And again, just like with Nicholas Payton, kind of typifies that quintet sound in the 90s. To me, Kenny Garrett, and look, I'd be remiss to not mention Branford Marsalis. Well, we did mention him on the Roy record, but I mean, how many great 90s records did Branford Marsalis?
I know, that's what I'm saying. We need to have a Marsalis day here.
We have to go
through all our favorites. Because for me, it was hard to... Anyway, we'll get into it later.
Yeah.
You know what I think makes this album, what pushes it over the top, are the compositions, the tunes. They're as influential. Kenny Garrett's writing on this album is influential as any of the playing.
Yeah, absolutely. And just the way he sets up a saxophone quartet.
Yeah.
And the balance of that, the balance of the tunes, they're all bangers, but this is not just a bunch of like hits thrown together. This, you know, as we thoroughly discussed and explored on the sesh many months ago, this is an album that listening from beginning to end, it's like listening to just, an opera or a great novel or a great movie where it's just like so complete. Each part, there's all these moments that happen and we're going to hear some. Let's hear it instead of hearing me talk about it. How about that?
This is The House That Nat Built from Songbook. This is 1997, Kenny Garrett's Songbook. Keeps going. It's so good, man. The whole album, if you don't know Songbook, it's such a beautiful work of art.
Yeah.
That's such a great form, that tune, The House That Nat Built.
It's just two sections.
Love it, dude. Yeah. Love it. Well, this was really fun.
You know what? I think that it's great that we kind of landed on that, although we may have a bonus.
We do have a bonus. We're going to go out on the bonus.
But there's a little controversy because I had a different bonus, but that's okay. It's all good. That the way that they play on that, I just realized, is to me, is such a great example of the 90s sound, if you're going to say what that is. In that it was very much like, it's always difficult to reduce things down to like, that's this, and then 10 years the next day. I mean, it never goes just like that. There's an evolution of it.
Yeah.
But I think for this general era, that certainly started before the 90s, even some into the 80s. But if you think about the way this rhythm section was playing, the way that Kenny Garrett is playing with them, man, it is right down the middle with the groove. You know what I'm saying? It's like, D's, yeah, stick up. And then there's a lot of polyrhythms underneath, both in terms of get. But everything is very much not metronomic, but very much like there's not this kind of laid back, and I don't mind it, but like the kind of way that came up in the 2010s and stuff, where it's like everything's pulled back a little bit and not quite lined up. It's just a different style. But in terms of like this era, and I think that's why a lot of people, like, you listen to that, Stopping the Biscuit, where it's like stank, gang. Greg Hutchinson, Tane, like all the Brian Blade, like we're just like right there down the middle of the groove. And that's what gives it that sound, I think.
I always get a little bit sad, not sad, but a little melancholy listening to this record, because we lost Kenny Kirkland not long after this record, the very next year.
Right.
And so this is one of the last recordings that he was on, and he's playing his ass off on the whole thing.
Yeah.
And
somebody mentioned Kenny Garrett's. Yeah, I'm sorry, I might have misspoken. I meant Kenny Kirkland.
Kenny Kirkland,
who left us. Yeah, Kenny Garrett's very much still with us and killing it and doing amazing.
Awesome, man. So we do have a bonus, and I wanted to add this because I knew you wouldn't do it, because, like I said, you're on some of these of the greatest records of the 90s. Peter Martin was out there doing it in the 90s.
It just means I'm old AF. That's what you're saying.
And there was a whole era there where Joshua Redman was making albums in the mid to late 90s. Spirit of the Moment, You know, what was the one someone just recommended on?
See, here. that was my thing. I don't mind doing. I absolutely think Joshua Redman should be on here. Somebody said Mood Swing.
Mood Swing.
I love that. That would have been album. Probably the other one. Is I realize it's not actually. It's from 2000, which is the one with the. Or no.
Beyond.
Yeah, I love that. That was recorded, I think, in 99, though.
Yeah.
But it came
it
out in 2000. That's a great one.
But don't sleep on this one, man. This is Freedom in the Groove. Yeah. If you haven't heard Freedom in the Groove, it's so, so, so much fun. My friends and I in high school learned a lot of these arrangements. Mm. And so I was back in the day before I even knew you. I was copping your stuff. And so we'll go out on this. Thanks, everybody, for hanging with us. Check out the Spotify playlist.
Yes.
And let us know, what are your favorite albums of the 90s? We got some good stuff going on here in the chat. But for our YouTube folks, let us know what you're listening to from the 90s.
From the 90s. Very dogmatic. And if you're on the podcast, go over to the YouTube channel. Check out this episode. You can comment there. We can gather to discuss 90s albums. But beloved, forgotten, and forlorn that I'm sure we missed.
This is 1996, Joshua Redman, Freedom in the Groove, Joshua Redman on tenor saxophone, Peter Bernstein on guitar, Christopher Thomas on bass, Brian Blade on the drums, and our own Peter Martin on the piano. This is Hide and Seek. Mm. Take care, everybody.
Peace. Oh, sorry. I had to throw in one thing. Are we still live?
Yeah.
Okay. So, because a lot of people have asked me about this, I can attest because okay. I was right there.
Okay.
That whole intro.
Yeah.
Everybody thinks that like Josh overdubbed that or played one part. He recorded that just straight through right while we were about to record it. That was not added on or don't all that baseline stuff. That was just I can attest. Just wanted to say that.
Is that okay? Now we know. Let's listen again.
Okay. There we go.
Okay, now I have to interrupt. So we're trying to end the show here.
Yeah.
Was that improvised, your line there? That counter melody?
No.
That harmony?
No, Josh wrote that.
That was all written.
But I think what happened was we were, the part before it, like I was supposed to play some chords. I was always like trying to figure out what to play over that first chorus.
Yeah.
And I ended up just like playing it unison instead of going right to the harmony.
Yeah.
Because I played it sometimes, I guess, with some chords or whatever, but I always liked it just kind of that and then going to the two separate lines.
Yeah.
And then having Burns. I mean, we played around with some different ideas.
But he composed that counter.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I might have changed it a little bit. Don't tell him, but you know.
Awesome. That's the kind of valuable insights that listeners want to know.
Shh. Okay, dear listeners. Shh.
Until next time.
You'll hear it.
Bam.
That's how we do it.
Kind of. Fun. Yeah, that was great, man.
That was fun, man.
The 90s.
I love the 90s, man. When I was in them.
I love the
90s. This is when robots entered our world and batteries were not good.
What?
Charge me back up. I don't know what I'm saying. What's up, YouTube?
This guy.
Is YouTube still with us? Did we get kicked off YouTube for 7 copyright violations? Because we certainly did them.
We might have. Yeah, what's up, everybody? Hope you enjoyed the 90s. Yeah, a lot of people are talking about Marsalis stuff. I realized as we were coming up with the list, I was like, there are no Marsalis albums on this entire 90s playlist, which seems weird. But you know what? They did so much in the 80s that it carried us through.
Yeah, Wynton was pretty much washed up by the 90s. Let's be honest.
Come on.
Right? I'm just kidding.
Dude.
No, but actually, I would say the most glaring omission in the Marsalis family, specifically for the 90s in the way we approached it, was probably Branford because the Branford Marsalis quartet was an outsized influence beyond just the great albums and stuff, and certainly some wonderful albums. But that was such a force in a maybe a similar way to the Kenny Garrett quartet, you know, had a lot of overlapping members as well as the Kenny.
I know, exactly. So right. Exactly.
There's that also.
Always going to sound good with Jeff Tane Watson and Kenny Kirkland.
Right,
yeah,
right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Well, thanks, folks.
Yeah. Do we have any other housekeeping as we like to do on here?
No, I'm just reading through the comments. I can't tell if Micah's being serious where he says, you guys should print a list of the albums you're discussing and let us get an email option. Is that a 90s reference, Micah, or do you really want that?
Print it, and we're going to send it by telex over to you, you know. Chris, I like Chris said, I'm kind of disappointed. I thought we were coming here to listen to some ragtime. Wrong 90s. That's what I'm
wrong
saying.
Wrong 90s.
I'm always joking about like the 90s, like the 1990s, you know, or the 1890s. That's what I'm talking about.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Cool. Well, we will be back next week as we do this cavalcade of communications and entertainment coming all at you, audio, video, and otherwise. And we thank you guys for being here and listening and hanging with us, right?
Yeah, man. Yeah. Cool. Good to listen to some music again, for sure.
He's like, yeah, man.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, cool. The 90s, man.
The 90s, dude.
Yeah.
I'm going to get my Reeboks on in a minute here.
The 90s was boring. I
used to have some Reeboks. Oh, you know what? This might even be going back to the 80s. No, I think it was early 90s. With the pump, the basketball ones.
Sure, I had the tennis ones, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. See, he's a country club guy. See, I'm from the hood. He's from the...
Please. Please.
Cool. Set up your GeoCities. You'll hear
GeoCities.
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 GeoCities. Cool. All right. Well, you know how we do this. We just sort of fiddle around to try to remember how we end this thing. Now, here we go. Boom.
Just going to mess around until something happens like the new school in the 90s.
Peace, y'all.